We are back with the great wine sensation, my beautiful friend, Jennifer Simonetti-Bryan, master of wine. This is Rob from the Drunken Grape. I'm always happy to have Jennifer here. She is the fourth female master of wine from the United States. There is only about 400 of them on the planet. They control academia and trade. This is the hardest designation by far to achieve in the wine world. And what makes Jennifer so special? We've all been to university. We've had that professor. In fact, most of them bore you to tears. Let's face it, too much information and not enough delivery. Jennifer's gift is the rare ability to take that information and disseminate it in such a clean, friendly, and often humorous way from the entry levels all the way to the most advanced levels. I've sat in some of the beginning courses of Jennifer's. I've also sat in with MWs and looked like the most uneducated guy in the group at the time, but I have seen everything on that window and it's quite impressive. And today we are talking rosé. We are in the Ides of March. As of the time of this recording, it is also International Women's Day. How fitting it is to have you on here, Jennifer. Congratulations to International Women's Day. Having had a twin sister and grown up with a lot of women, I've been heavily influenced by women in my life. So enough of that. Remember, ladies and gentlemen, smash the like, share the channel, subscribe to The Drunken Grape. When you do, hit the notification bell, select all so you do not miss any of this excellent content. Each and every week, we have extraordinary people, extraordinary drinks with extraordinary people on the virtual happy hour experience. So make sure to plug into that playlist too. Without any further delay, Jennifer, how the hell are you?
I'm doing great. Thanks so much for having me.
Yeah, it's always a delight. So you've been up to quite a few things lately. I know you have your blind tasting X course. I love sitting in that. It'll probably be the third time I sit in it to try to complete it. It's always difficult to do courses and business at the same time. I just really have to manage time a little better to get that done. So apologies to you. You also have your tasting course that just started, which I think is great. It's a guided tutored tasting on wines. And I think it's to get people to understand and experience more leading towards the blind tasting aspects. You've written numerous books. We're going to talk about this one right here. I have gotten about page 60. I've not read the whole thing. I think I got it got delivered a few days ago and I mistook it for another package. I opened it and I'm like, that's not the health products I was looking for. That's the rosé book. So this is great. I got the page 60 or so. And talk to us a little bit about it. What inspired you to write this and get into this? Because rosé was such a non-existent topic 20 years ago.
Yeah. Yeah. Back in 2010, my publisher, I wrote the 1 Minute Wine Master, which is a very similar concept where you have a quiz. And then when you get done with the quiz, you get placed into one of four categories. Now, the questions to the quiz are seemingly unrelated to wine, but they can answer a lot of questions about your palate preferences. So once you get done with the quiz, you get a number. It's kind of like a Cosmo quiz kind of thing. You get a number and then you get placed into one of four categories. So spring, summer, fall, or winter. And with that book, it was so successful. The publisher came to me a few years later and they're like, we want you to write a book on rosé. I'm like, oh, that's amazing. Because people really don't realize that there are different styles of rosé. And particularly even about 10 years ago, we saw Provence rosé really explode onto the scene. Now, I mean, maybe about 20 years ago, people knew White Zinfandel in this country, in the United States and in some other areas, but dry rosé was not as much of a thing back in the early 2000s, but it is now. And so looking at the different styles, I wanted to make sure people knew that there was a spring, summer, fall, winter kind of style for rosé, just like you have for other wines. You have wines that are in the spring category, which are very, it's just like it sounds, you know, delicate, light, and some are quite sweet. And then you've got the summer rosés, which have way more fruit. I mean, think of the summer. You've got some richness and ripeness going on. In fall, you've got some, maybe some even riper, maybe some spicy kind of tones to them. And then you've got some really rich, powerful winter rosés. It doesn't mean you know, drink them necessarily in the winter, but you can. These rosés, the winter category rosés, are those that are like, you know, those are the rosés that put hair on your chest. You know, those are like the
kind of like this one right here.
Styles, the deepest color. They're almost like red wines. Yeah. So those are a lot of fun. But that was the reason why I wrote it, was, you know, looking at the huge array of different style rosés there are out there that people may actually say that, oh, rosé is not for me, but they may be just tasting the wrong one.
Yeah. And you know, when you do wine courses, it takes you through just pretty much scoots through rosé. Just says, oh yeah, and by the way, unlike reds, they macerate for up to 3 weeks. It's 12 to 36 hours of fermentation with
the
skins.
Yeah, it's the afterthought.
Maybe up to a day or two. And oh, by the way, we either do the direct press or the bleed off method. Great. Next. And then just sort of scoots over it. I found this book really informative. Like, I'm on page 60. I'm learning a pile as I go. And it's not like I'm an amateur in the world of education of wine. I'm definitely competent. And what you mentioned is sort of broken down there with blush, crisp. You have a few things going on there that really break it down wonderfully in the guide. You know, this book is awesome. I'm going to actually bring it up as to where they can buy it on Amazon. But in here, you also have the flavor wheel. I love flavor wheels because they really break down. You also have the rosé quiz, which I took. You score up the 30 points, and it puts you into whether you like crisp, fruity, blush. You know, it's funny because I like crisp typically, but I have a wonderful Tavel here for the happy, happy hour. Cheers to you, Jennifer. I don't know if you have a drink in hand. You just moved. It might be difficult. But this one does start to resemble more of a pinkish red wine. It's deeper in color and hue. Tends to have a little more body, tannic structure. Definitely dry. Definitely balanced out with good levels of acidity. Tavel is a red, is a rosé appellation in the Rhone Valley, right? In the southern Rhone Valley, it's dedicated to rosé. But provincial wine, you mentioned that. My brother's wife, or past wife, she unfortunately had passed, but they live in Provence, the parents, and they send us wine every year. It reminds me of orange wine because it's a light blush almost, and it's crisp. And the thing is, these wines are awesome because even in Canada, people love to have trout and salmon throughout the winter. This makes a phenomenal blending partner. You know, those red cherry notes, strawberry. Sometimes you get into raspberry notes as well. The acidity chops through the fattiness of those dishes. Those fruit flavors I described definitely complement the fish as well. It's and it's interesting
what
because
I love about Provence. Yeah, Provence and Rosé, those are two regions in southern France. So you've got Provence style, which, as you were talking about, is like, it's barely pink, right? And it's very sea breeze and mineral and crisp and light and delicate. And that's at one end of the spectrum. And people love it for that crispness and lightness, particularly with light Mediterranean fare with fish and shrimp. But then with Tavel, it's at the other total opposite end of the spectrum. Now, there's the same grapes. Same grapes in both of them, but because of how they're made, you've got one that's delicate and light and one that's rich and full-bodied and viscous and really very complex in a very different way. And it would probably go way better with something like a salmon. I mean, because it's weightier, Tavel, it can hold something much weightier and bigger. I mean, I love Tavel with like a with chicken salad with cranberries and stuff like that. So it can handle a lot more than something that's really delicate.
Yeah, and rosé is definitely something women are passionate about too. Like, you see the shirts here in Canada, rosé all day. And, you know, they have bridal parties with rosé. They love pink. Ontario's exploded with rosé production. Started with Ladybug by Malavoie. That is a wine that is also tends to be a little bit off dry, so it's on the sweeter side. You mentioned around the year 2000. It's like Matus, I believe, was sort of the what laid the groundwork in Europe for the red wine explosion. Saw a bottle of that today. You can buy it for $10. It's definitely on the bargain side. Same thing with white Zinfandel. You mentioned palates and sweetness. You know, Americans love soda. I call the United States a soda pop culture. And with that,
we love our sweetness.
White Zinfandel just drop shipped right in there. It was a stuck fermentation, was it not, on regular Zinfandel that led to white Zinfandel? It's a higher sugar value, lower alcohol.
It started with it. It was kind of like an oops, but it was like, oh, this is kind of really nice. What I love with, but you can't knock the blush category. I know people who know a lot about wine will may poo-poo a white Zinfandel or a Matus or something like that. But these wines go incredibly well with spicy cuisine. So if you're going with, you know, super spicy Chinese or Indian cuisine, those wines go exceptionally well with it. So yeah, if you had a Provence rosé with something like that, it would be so overpowering. It would overpower the wine. You wouldn't be able to taste the wine at all.
And yeah, I've done that. You're right.
Rosé lacks sweetness. It would make the food taste just bitter. So it's those blush category wines are, you know, super lovely with spicy stuff.
You know, and it's funny because I hear it all now and I never really thought of that. I've learned something already on the set. You know, and it's true because when I think spicy foods, I think lager and beer, which is a natural pairing being in the beer world. And then I think sweet wines like Gewurz or Riesling come into play. But what an awesome opportunity to go out, get a wine that's very inexpensive that pairs wonderfully because everyone likes their spicy tacos, their spicy Tex-Mex food in the States. What a nice run with or a pairing with white Zinfandel. You know, a bottle of Gallo Winery, or is it Sutter's Winery as
Sutter
well?
Home.
Sutter Home. Awesome, awesome pairing potential there. So the other thing, I'm going to bring up your book here because I think people need to know where this is. We're also going to show your website shortly. But this book, and I love it because it's such, you take such, you know, you've got a gift of taking academia and turning it into a pleasurable read. You know, I'm actually finishing off believe it or not, still working on it, the second part of the Italian Wine Scholar. And the information gets caught, but the trouble with a lot of these books is they don't make it enjoyable enough for the reader. You know, you start reading it and you're like, wow, this is just pure fact. I love the facts being a wine professional, but partially a wine professional, but it's better if they made it much more joyful at the same time, because I find what happens is like you have a writing style that somebody reads this and they're going to start retaining things pretty quickly because it's easy. It's a flowing style. Everything comes in seamless and there's a joyful character to the reading of all this information because there is also an awful lot of information in here. It's almost a mini, it's basically a course on rosé and wine without even knowing that
you're reading
a course on rosé and wine.
I wanted to make sure that if anyone who read it, they would, if they knew a little something about wine, that they would learn more. But I also wanted it to be okay, like if my grandma read it, like if she read it and she knows nothing about wine, first of all. So if she read it and she could follow it, I figured, okay, so this might be good for a wide range of people. But
You know what?
So
a great gifting.
That was a lot of fun, right?
That's cool. And what a great gifting. I saw you also attributed it to your mother in the beginning of the book itself. There was a little prelude, you know, thanking her. I thought that was great when I was cracking into it. What also I found great is you get through the history of it. Like in order to understand the development of things, you do have to have a snapshot of time. And that's really important when you're educating people. I also love how you break it down. I'm doing the test here, how you can add tannin. I've got a bit of ground cinnamon here and I'm actually going to sprinkle it into the wine. Shaking around.
You're gonna add it to-
and this actually teaches. This actually helps people. These are some of the experiences Jennifer shares and imparts in these books. You know, I've got a bottle of vodka here too. So if you want to know what alcohol and heat is like, vodka, nothing goes down more burning and a raw burning sensation than a neutral or abbreviated spirit like vodka. But adding a little bit of cinnamon there, cinnamon tends to be very tannic. and it lifts a lot of characters out. And these are experiences and that can share with you the growth of your palate if you're a novice. Wine's for everybody. Wine is also a subjective thing. There's no right or wrong answer. And I love how you point that out, that you never pick up lentils in Grüneveltliner, for instance. And it's just, that is really important to know because everybody's palates are different. And I also love that you pick out a scientific fact that men can take more alcohol because they have higher muscle mass. You're just bigger and more dense. Women have better palates, and that's actually been scientifically proven too. Women can actually sense things. And you also get into orthonasal and retronasal as far as tasting, as far as, you know, the soft palate, your sense of smell. Yeah. Picks up about 200 different aromas on average, is about 90% of your tasting experience. How you talk about how the tongue and the palate itself and the mouth only picks up five basic things, you know, salty, sweet, sour, umami, and bitter.
My favorite test is when people say that flavors is different than aromas. I'm like, oh, you think so, do you? Okay, so close your nose. And then try to sip wine and see if you can taste any flavors with your nose closed, because you can't. You know, if you close your nose and you try to sip wine, you're just going to feel the sweet, sour, salt, bitter umami, because that's all your tongue can do. The moment you pull your hand away from your nose, you get this influx of aromas and flavors. That's what they are, you know. So it's what you were talking about earlier by adding cinnamon to one glass or adding vodka to another. That is called a component tasting. And that is definitely how I trained my palate for tannins and stuff like that. So sharing that kind of knowledge can help people improve their palates.
Yeah. And I just took a sip of this and wow, the tannins, you can feel the astringency. It's like I just chewed on a black tea bag. Basically, like, you know, how you've got that tea has that astringency. And I'm just like, my mouth just turned into a barren desert for a minute. And it's like, it's kind of cool how that works. And it's the insights that you share in this. And this is the thing I love about you, because you take complex information and break it down. It really shows the level of intellect and the level of education you really have at the very highest level. The fact that you can take all this and compress it. And this was written not too long after you became an MW, I believe, because you finished it, what, about 2008? So this is a number of years ago that you got this book done. We're also going to take a look at something else here, because I love the courses you're currently offering. We're going to take a look at the Home of the Master of Wine online. I love this. Study wine smarter. You know what?
Yeah.
This is great. There's going to definitely be wine students tuning into this, because every time I have you on a video, the wine community wakes up and takes a look at it. I think they're also the most viewed videos I have on my channel. But that's great. I think it has a lot to do with the synergy we have, the character you bring, and the integrity that you bring to this business, which I think is incredible. Yeah, anytime. But we take a look at this. Study wine smarter, faster, easier, better.
Yeah.
And, you know,
it took me so long to learn. And some people think it's overnight. It's not overnight. You know, it took me the better part of a decade in order to get to where I am in terms of my credentials. And I want to help people drastically condense that time. So I want you to learn from my mistakes so that you don't have to spend 10 years, 8 years, whatever it is to get to whatever level you want to get at in your goal. So that's why I started Master Wine Online. So, and particularly I wanted to help the WSET or the Wine Scholar Guild or any of those who are in wine classes. Because as you mentioned, they can be really tedious, and some of the things that you learn are very dry academically, but some of the things you won't learn in those courses, like teaching you how to blind taste or teaching you how to taste for quality, you don't necessarily learn that in the class itself. So you actually learn a lot of that in life experience. So I wanted to take that and be able to really bring it home in learning how to do some of these things.
Yeah, and the Blind Tasting X program's awesome. This is really, really crucial. If you're doing your WSET Level 4 diploma, which is like basically almost the equivalent of doing a master's degree in wine at that stage, if you're working on some more advanced courses like the Wine Scholar Guild courses, and you want to jump in because they're theory, but you really want to experience tasting, because you hit up the old world, you hit up French, you hit up Italy, you hit up Spain really well in this program. I love how you cross-reference acidity differences even between the nuances of things like Spanish wines having less acidity in general to Italian wines, for instance, even though the profiles and the laterals, as you describe them, laterals being similar wines can have similar profiles. There's nuances that make huge differences when you're tasting it. You cover all this, and I think it's great. It also allows, you know, you have a program for the non-MW, non-MS or diploma students, so it's more the general public can engage as well. And I think it's just awesome that you offer this. This is about the diversity in your offerings. You know, this is really showcases why you're an extraordinary person, and I couldn't think of somebody better to record this on and International Women's Day. And you know what? It's actually by fluke. I didn't even realize until it was today. And I was like, oh, wow, it's International
You did it on purpose, Women's didn't you? Day.
Well, I think it was fate that did this. And I think it's great that that happened. But these things are all reasonably priced for the amount of expertise that are given in them as well. You know, it's may set you back, I don't know what it is, $1,400, something like that. But here's the thing.
A few times a year, I do sell it at $14.95. But if you're a WSET or an MW candidate, I do give discounts. So
that's great. And here's the thing. The amount of money and time you're going to save them is crucial. If you can take a year off the study program, forget $1,495. You've probably put $7,000 or $8,000 back in their pocket, if not more. So these are things you've got to weigh when you're looking at it. You know,
particularly if you're going for a credential. Yeah,
absolutely. So we're going to wrap this up. Listen, I know where people can find you. They can hit you up on the website. You are on LinkedIn under your direct profile. In fact, I can just bring that up very quickly. Why not? As we're talking here, ladies and gentlemen, make sure to reach out to Jennifer. Make sure to check out her offerings. She is all over the internet. She is offering all kinds of different programs for you, whether you're an aficionado, you're beginning your wine studies, or you're really into the most advanced stages. And I think these things are absolutely critical. It's also great to be offered these types of things at a time where we are really doing a lot more distance and virtual learning. I know you've really mastered the whole virtual platform, and this is just awesome. So we're going to bring up the profile here just a second, ladies and gentlemen. I always love playing with technology, this software tool. Big shout out to Riverside FM. But just to close it off, let's see if it comes up. There we are. There's the profile. So you can also see Jennifer's been all over the world as far as television, media exposure. Definitely one of the very top wine minds. I wouldn't be surprised if you're one of the people they point to after the great Yancis Robinson retires or moves on from the wine world. You know, I really put her at sort of the pinnacle of it with all of her skill sets and expertise. But you're kind of like one of her next in line to take over. And I think it's great that you've actually just sort of moving into that direction. And, you know, this is awesome. So make sure to reach out to her, ladies and gentlemen. Again, make sure to like, subscribe, and share this channel. Make sure to hit the notification bell and select all when you do. Cheers to you and the happy, happy hour. Ladies and gentlemen, whatever you decide to do, at the time of this recording, happy International Women's Day. This is Rob and Jennifer from The Drunken Grape.